You may be seated. Join with me in prayer. Lord Jesus, we come before you, Holy Father, and we cry out to you that you would move in our hearts and minds, that you would persuade us to your truth, that you would open up our eyes to see the unseen realm, and that you would give us understanding of what is going on in our circumstances around us, so that we might be alert and so that we might respond in the way that you are calling. Oh Lord, would you do this now? Would you do this over these next few minutes in our midst as we lay before your word? In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We are in the throes of an invisible but very real spiritual conflict. It's not going to be on the news. No one's covering it. But it's affecting every person around the world, from the city of Boston to every country and every nation. It's harming the church and harming every soul. You know, I intellectually believed what the Apostle Paul taught here, that we wrestle not against flesh and blood, which is that the real conflict is not human to human. And of course, that's exactly what we're led to believe, isn't it? That it's this group against that group, and that's where all the opposition really lies. But the Apostle Paul is saying here that the conflict is not between flesh and blood, not at all. It's in the invisible realm, and it is with these dark forces. I've had the privilege of serving here in this congregation for just over 12 months now. Last week celebrated 12 months. And it's been wonderful to be here, and though I intellectually really believed in this kind of spiritual warfare that our text is getting at, over the past year, I've really come to see that it is quite the case. I've seen it in my own life and in around those around me in ways that I'd probably best not to tell you. But it's been very powerful, very difficult, very real. My wife and I have felt like we're walking around with bullseyes on our back. Never before in my job at Harvard, when I was working as a research professor there, I didn't experience anything like it. But as soon as I came into this position, things really have changed. And I've seen it in other ways too around the church. I'll share a couple very minor stories, but they still kind of stick with me. This summer, over the front stairs of our church, where "My Country, 'Tis of Thee" was first sung, I've seen a couple things that have happened. One, this happened a couple months ago. There was someone on the Freedom Trail, they were reading our signs out front, and some stranger, I happened to just be kind of eavesdropping, seeing what people are doing out there in the front and just kind of watching. Some stranger comes up to the person who is reading the signs and says, "Oh," and he starts bad-mouthing our church, saying evil, really, that we're an evil place and we've done evil things. And he was actually bad-mouthing our missions program and our sending of people to Hawaii and all the evil effects that action caused. I was dumbfounded that this person would come up to a stranger and start bad-mouthing our church I'm not exactly sure why. Maybe our text has something to say about it. Or actually, just a few weeks ago, I was walking to lunch, walking past the front stairs. I had just gone past it, a little further down Tremont Street towards the Granary Burial Ground. And all of a sudden, someone stands up on the stairs. He was sitting down talking to another fellow. And he starts looking right at me, and he starts yelling. I was probably 30 feet away by this point. And he says, "This is our city. This is my town." And then he sat down. I kept on walking like, "Oh, okay." And then a few steps went by, and then all of a sudden it dawned on me. Whose voice was I really hearing? And indeed, whose city does this belong? Well, as the church, we must recognize and respond to the very real but non-flesh and blood enemy. Who is the enemy? What are the enemy's strategies? And brothers and sisters, how should we respond? Those are the three questions I'd like to address this morning. So first, who is the real enemy? Well, as you can see in our text from Ephesians 6, verse 11, he's called the devil. And then in verse 16, he's called the evil one. Earlier on in Ephesians, in chapter 2, verse 2, the Apostle Paul, referring to the same figure, describes him as the prince or the ruler of the kingdom of the air. And then again in verse 2 of chapter 2, he calls him the spirit. Again, it's an invisible being, not flesh and blood. The spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. And in the New Testament, he's called the devil, or he's called Satan. The terms are, one comes out of the Greek, another comes out of the Hebrew, but they're interchangeable. They have interchangeable meanings, referring to the accuser. Satan? The devil? Michael, how can you possibly believe in an archaic, simplistic, imaginary Halloween figure? This is 21st century Boston, not the 1693 Salem witch trials. Well, hold on a second. Can't prove, and you can't disprove, that the devil exists. But we can use reason and we can use faith. Let me at least give a few reasons of why you should be skeptical of the skepticism that Satan exists. We should question the skepticism that the devil doesn't exist because it's just a bit narrow and elitist. In fact, there have been two polls most recently done, I think the most recent I've been able to find is 2007, two different national polls showing that 7 out of 10 of Americans actually believe that the devil exists. So it's a little strange to me that someone can have such confidence of what the spiritual reality is when it's actually a little bit out of keeping with even what the American public actually believes. Now, of course, a poll doesn't prove anything, but it does show that there's a little bit of academic snobbery going on when people just dismiss it so quickly and so easily. Not only so, but non-Western cultures around the world recognize the unseen realm, and in particular, evil forces and evil spirits. And you have to wonder, is this anti-supernatural viewpoint really so superior? Who are they to be so certain? Or is it in fact this anti-supernaturalism is itself a culturally narrow perspective that yields several blind spots? That's a good question and something to consider, this elitism. Well, not only so, but I think we should question the skepticism that the devil exists because it can't explain intractable, persistent suffering that continues to exist in our day. Humanists such as Steven Pinker at Harvard advocate that the world's getting better because of education, because of technology, because of globalization. And for the ways that it is getting better, we can be thankful and grateful and celebrate it. But it is a bit strange that, and perhaps ironic, that no matter how much we seem to work to make things better, suffering is not getting eliminated. And sometimes, in the most interesting ways, our human achievements end up yielding more suffering than we ever could have intended. Just think of World War II. What a wonderful thing to celebrate the end of World War II. But it took the dropping of 2 nuclear bombs. And now it's led to nuclear proliferation 70 or so years later, in which the world is in a more dangerous place than ever we could have imagined. Some unintended consequences. And you wonder, here we are in the midst of the shadow of the potential suffering that's there, and we have to wonder what lies potentially behind it. Or just think of all the amazing advancements in medical technologies that we've seen over the last several decades. And yet at the very same time, there's been an exponential increase around the world of abortions through medical technologies. Measuring from 1980 to today, 1.45 billion abortions have taken place. No matter what your view on abortion, You surely would agree with me that that can't be a very healthy or good thing for the human race. There's the intractability, it seems to me, of poverty, racism, drug use, murders, rape, war, genocide. The Enlightenment advocates say, well, just give us a little bit more time, just a little bit more human ingenuity, and we'll fix these problems. Really? Are you sure? I think we should work on these problems. We should seek to eradicate these things. But the Christian view suggests that there's something actually more powerful and sinister at work than just our own human foibles and human error. There's something active working against us that's even creating our achievements to lead to these unintended consequences that are hurting many people. Well, I think the primary reason to acknowledge the devil's existence is not just these rational reasons that I think help partly explain things, but it's Jesus' own testimony. Jesus describes the devil not as symbolic, but as a malicious spiritual being who opposes God and every human being. In fact, 25 out of the 29 references to Satan in the four Gospels are directly taught by Jesus, in which he's either talking about the demonic realm or he's talking to the demonic realm. Remember, he even has an extended conversation with Satan in the desert, recorded in Matthew 4 and Luke chapter 4. There's an enormous amount of material in which, when you read the Gospels, the dark realm with Satan as its ruler is there. And you have to ask your question, well, some would say, well, Jesus didn't say that. It's the disciples who came later, and they kind of put it all there. Really? Does that explain all of the evidence? To take out all of the evidence of Jesus' exorcisms, his teachings about Satan, as well as his encounters with evil, would take out a lot of the Gospels themselves, spread out in four different tellings of Jesus' life. I don't think the disciples could have made this up. There's too much material spread out throughout all of the Gospels, indicating that the source of this engagement is Jesus himself. And if that's the case, it really leads us to two potential solutions. One solution is that Jesus believed he was engaging evil, but he was just wrong. He was mistaken. So he wasn't lying about it. He was just a little bit crazy. But in fact, not even his opponents, the Pharisees, made such an argument. They saw the engagement that Jesus had in these exorcisms, and they did not question the factuality of what was taking place. So the idea that Jesus was just mistaken, honestly mistaken, doesn't work. Leaves you with one final argument, is that Jesus was a liar. He knew that Satan didn't exist, but he fabricated these stories, playing to the fears of people, and somehow was able to create a hoax around people so that they would follow and believe him. And that leaves me questioning, really? Does that explain the stories that we read? Does that adequately explain the life of Jesus? Is it more likely that Jesus is a liar and that the devil doesn't exist? Or that Jesus is telling the truth, and perhaps it's actually the devil who wants us to believe that Jesus is a liar? Well, both reason and faith, I think, together at least cause me to believe that Jesus and the scriptures are right as they talk about the evil realm and talk about the demonic realm, including Satan. The scriptures describe the devil as a created personal spiritual being who holds all kinds of traits of personality. He's not just a symbol. He has incredible intellect, ability to deceive, ambition, jealousy, hatred, anger. He is one who brings questions and accuses others, and he even has the audacity to command Jesus in Luke chapter 4. And though Satan was created good by God, he chose out of his own will to reject God's will. Why? Well, we can only speculate, but I think some have helpfully suggested that when God created mankind, he elevated man and he commanded and gave the role to the angels, who are more powerful, to serve mankind. That's part of their angel means, to be a messenger and a servant. And Satan, being vastly more powerful than humans, objects to this reordering where the lesser is to be served by the greater. How could God arrange it to be this way? That's unfair. That's not right. The lesser should serve the greater. We should serve the angels, and yet God has reversed it so that they are to serve us. And so he rebelled and said, no, this is wrong. And this is why he's called the evil one, which he's become unredeemably committed to oppose God and to oppose God's way with those that he's created. His motive is destruction. Jesus, in fact, in John 8, calls him a murderer from the beginning. You see, from the very beginning, his intent was to destroy the human race, because he hates us and he hates what God has done by giving us this glory and honor, as it says in Psalm 8, made a little lower than angels, but raised up with glory and honor. And his justification to do this is his own power. He claims terrestrial authority in Luke chapter 4. He says to Jesus, all this authority has been given me, and I give it to whom I will. The whole world, it says in 1 John 5, lies in the power of the evil one. Paul calls him the God of this world in 2 Corinthians 4. He's called the ruler of the power of the air in Ephesians 2. He's called the ruler of demons in Matthew 9. And then as we read in Ephesians 6, verse 12, it's not just Satan by himself, but he is a ruler of others, a ruler of an entire dark realm, because we wrestle not against flesh and blood, in verse 12, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realm. So it's not just him alone. He has an entire army that works with him and under him in a kind of military hierarchy, and there are different passages in the scriptures that suggest that that's something like that is going on, that different demons have different strengths. Gospels suggest that, and that there is even some level of territorialness, which is speculation, but there's something to it. Well, as the church, we must recognize and respond to this real enemy, who's not flesh and blood. The real enemy is not one another. It's not the church against the world, and it's not various world parties against one another. The real enemy is Satan. The real enemy is Satan. And it leads to a second question. What are the enemy's strategies? You read in verse 11, it says, put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. The word there for schemes, it's methods, or it's a military idea, it's strategies. And it's not one, it's not a strategy, it's strategies. So the devil in his intellect is able to find many, many weaknesses and ways to work and to operate in order to do what he wants done. Well, what are these strategies? What are these schemes? Let me lay out very quickly, as best as I can, five. Five of the devil's strategies. The first, strategy number one, is that you will never easily recognize him. That's part of his nature. He's called the father of lies. He's a deceiver from the very beginning. And within his nature, he uses that ability to deceive and to lie and to be very good at it, so that we can rarely directly recognize him. There's no red tail. There's no pitchfork. There's no Halloween costumes going on here. He talks as a friend with wisdom, just like he talked to Eve in the garden as a serpent with wisdom. Apostle Paul says in 2 Corinthians 11, 14, that he is an angel of light, part of the angelic realm. And he uses his luminosity to trick us and to deceive. He's able to counterfeit miracles, according to 2 Thessalonians 2:9. And so it requires that we're constantly testing what we're seeing, what we're hearing. We bring tests to it, especially by using and knowing the Word of God, making sure that something is centered on the gospel. you will not easily recognize them. Strategy number two, the enemy targets personal pressure points. This is part of his genius. He targets your personal pressure points. He learns about you. He has ways of finding out about us. And he figures out what works and what doesn't work. He doesn't follow the Geneva Convention. He fights nasty. That's how he works. So if you have pride, he'll figure out ways to play to it. If you struggle with confidence, he'll constantly find a way to bring your mistakes back to you and remind you of them. If you've been wounded in the past, he'll find a way to remind you of that wound and try to re-raise the bitterness and perhaps your unwillingness or your reluctance to forgive. If you have a big mouth, like I can, or an anger problem, he'll use it against you. Absolutely. He'll find a foothold and he'll target you with it. If you have a disposition prone to depression, he'll try to initiate that process within you. He is conniving and he seeks out your pressure points and he'll go right after it. He finds the chink in the armor and that's where he'll apply the pressure. If you're a new Christian, he'll immediately try to fight to steal away your faith and discourage you. If you're tired, there will be certain suggestions to stay up late and turn on the television at 11:30 at night or do some internet browsing. And I think probably most of us agree almost nothing comes out of television that's good and it's worth it at 11:30 at night. If you're new to the city of Austin, he'll try to emphasize reasons or give you reasons not to prioritize church or being involved in a small group. Or he'll get really, really dirty and he'll go after and target your children or some other loved one and try to harm them because he knows that that will harm you. So you won't recognize him very easily, and two, he targets your personal pressure points. Strategy number three is that the attack comes in three modes, and it's always empowered by a lie or a falsehood. The three modes are temptation, accusation, and affliction. First, temptation. Temptation is that enticement in either your mind, the ideas, or your emotions to do something that's wrong. Should I take that extra glance absorbing her body? The lie is, well, no one will see me and it won't hurt anyone. No, that's not true. Or you think to yourself, I could manipulate the numbers just a little bit to my advantage. And the lie is, oh, well, I worked really hard for this and I'm underappreciated anyway. Or you imagine that person who's been a little out of line and that little extra word to dig in, and you think to yourself, well, he needs to be put into his place anyway. So the temptations come in these enticements, and there's always an embedded lie. And there's only one way to respond. It's partly with this armor, and the very first piece of armor that you're supposed to use is the truth, the belt of truth. The way to respond to temptation is to speak the truth to the lie that's embedded there. Tell yourself the truth to diffuse the temptation. Put on the helmet of salvation, which is your identity in Jesus Christ, remembering who you are, that you belong to Jesus Christ, not to yourself or to any other. And you put on, when temptation comes, you got to put on your very best and fastest New Balance sneakers. You gotta run. When temptation comes, you turn and you run. But you don't just run. You put on the gospel of peace that prepares your feet. You start using the gospel and you start preaching the gospel to others. You serve in ways to diminish the power of temptation over you. And that's part of the blessing of preaching the gospel and telling others about it at work, in your neighborhood, in your family. You start telling people, you look for ways to have spiritual conversations. And the more you do this, it does affect and lessen the temptation. While he uses temptation, he also uses accusation. The enemy reminds you of your failures, your many sins, your constant shortcomings. He tries to kick up the dust storm of all the fears that you know float around in your mind. Accusations find their success when you, again, you accept some lie. Satan lies. He finds ways to lie about you. Oh, you're not worthy to receive mercy. You're unlovable. That sin really is unforgivable. No, you're not good enough. Or he starts lying about God. He doesn't really love you. He's not going to stick with you when the going gets tough. He's not going to pay that bill. Mm-mm. You're on your own. Prayer isn't powerful enough to save your marriage. Don't believe that silly promise. No, how do we respond to these kinds of accusations? We put on the breastplate of righteousness. We remind ourselves of the fundamental reality that no, you're not good enough. No, we don't really deserve mercy. But in his lavish love, he gives us through Jesus Christ, he imputes to us his righteousness. So no, you're not worthy, neither am I. But Christ is worthy, and he counts you worthy by giving you his righteousness and taking away your sin. Praise be to Jesus. I am his, and he is mine. That's the truth. And you speak to the accusation, this reality. Or finally, he uses affliction. He uses the brokenness of this world to vex us with trouble. He'll bring physical illness, or he'll plague you with some kind of mental health problem. There will be an unexpected death or a work conflict, a loss of a job, some broken relationship, a house fire, a lawsuit. There will be some kind of character assault against you by a former friend. He uses people around you to afflict you, and that causes you to have a choice within the affliction, whether you will follow him and praise his name. This is where you need the shield of faith to absorb these darts of the evil one. You, faith, believing in him and believing in his promises, even within the affliction, I will never leave you or forsake you. God is faithful, Paul says in 1 Corinthians 10. He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear, but when you are tempted, he will provide a way out so that you can endure it. That's true in affliction. Just look for the way out. There is a way. It's a promise that he's given. So strategy three is that he used three modes, and it's always empowered by the lie, and you need the armor of God to turn around that lie and speak truth to it. Strategy number four, and I'll say this very quickly, the evil one targets cultural beliefs, social structures, and culture-shaping institutions. There's a lot there, and I can't really go into it, but Satan is less about possessing individuals, and he's much more engaged about oppressing an entire people. And you do this by attacking the social structures of how institutions and peoples interact with one another, and by attacking and molding the underlying social beliefs. Because if you can get at those things, then you affect absolutely everyone, and you distort and distract people from knowing the love of God. There's a lot to say about that. We'll postpone it for another day. But this is a key strategy, and it demands that we, as a church, we have to be culturally engaged. Why? Because Satan's culturally engaged. And so we, too, need to be engaged in these lies, calling truth within the workplace, within the different fields of the university. We need to be thinking and working and using the Lord's power to demolish arguments, Paul says, and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God. Strategy five, this is the last one. He uses and attacks the church in order to render it harmless. Let me share three ways that he does this. First, through false teaching. It's his oldest trick against the people of God. He tries to confuse them about what the nature of truth is and get people who believe in Jesus to follow after some other lie. Satan knows the scriptures well, and he manipulates it in order to try to manipulate us. Martin Luther said, when you look for the devil, don't forget to look in the pulpit. Well, which is a warning. It's a warning to you to be on your guard Everything you hear must come under the scriptures and you must test it. And for me, everything that I study and work and the other pastors as well, we must make sure that it is consistent and right with the Word of God. So he uses false teaching. Well, what if that doesn't work? Well, then he goes after the spiritual leaders of a congregation. You know, you've heard it. Greed, maybe a sexual fall of the pastor, maybe people who are being controlling or abusive to the congregation, or just maybe being plain old lazy and not doing and working hard as a spiritual leader. All of that works pretty well, and when the spiritual leader falls, there's chaos in the church, renders it harmless. If that doesn't work, he'll try to arouse bitterness, cause a kerfuffle, which, you know, all those little fires in the church, it just requires all the spiritual leaders, the elders, the pastors to be putting out all the little fires. Meanwhile, the gospel isn't getting advanced. We're not discipling people. We're not focusing on what we're doing. So brothers and sisters, please don't cause a kerfuffle. Well, if that doesn't work, he'll just afflict the shepherds with illness. Or like I said earlier, he'll go after the family members. And that will just cause a major distraction and a desperate grief. So you need to remember to pray. Please pray for your pastors. Please pray for their families. We are desperate for your prayers. If that doesn't work, well, he'll embolden local or state persecution. And of course, the spiritual leaders are the first one to be thrown into jail. Or he'll just get us to stop praying and become lazy about it. And that leads into a third and final death blow to the church. He'll arouse our self-reliance. It says, be strong in the Lord, which means you can be strong in other things. You can be strong in yourself. What are signs of self-reliance? Oh, there are many. Division, arguments, hustling over power and control within the church, a loss of gospel urgency, a focus on secondary matters, whether it's budgets or organizational minutiae or style of music or the color of the drapes. Thank God we don't have any drapes. Or he'll cause fear within us to take risks, risks for the gospel, whether individually or in our corporate life. And he'll diminish the importance of prayer, and we'll get really lazy about praying together. That's all signs of self-reliance. These are five of the strategies. Well, let me close. If we were going to begin to recognize and to respond to this real non-flesh and blood enemy, how are we to respond to the conflict? How are we to respond? Well, four times the Apostle Paul in Ephesians 6, he says, stand. 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 Stand up. Someone earlier at the 8:30 said, I really wanted to stand when you were saying that. If you want to stand, go ahead. Stand up for the Lord. Stand with the Lord. The temptation when battle comes, when that evil day, Paul refers to, when the evil day comes, the temptation is to shrink. The temptation is to stay in bed. The temptation is to, well, for me, go play golf. The temptation is to hide and to stay in the back. We are called to stand with the Lord and to stand with His church. In fact, all of the commands here in Ephesians 6, to stand and to put on and so on, they're all in the plural. In other words, what Paul is seeing, he's not seeing a bunch of little individual soldiers with your swords and shields running around. He is seeing one soldier, and that soldier is the church itself, fully equipped with the gospel, with the Holy Spirit poured out on it, with one people, with all of the spiritual giftings linked arm in arm, marching forward on the front lines. And believe you me, we are on the front lines. And so we're all left with a choice to shrink back, a choice to sit down, a choice not to recognize the war, the spiritual war that is taking place in our very midst, in this very city, on our very front steps, to ignore it, and to get all caught up with other things, or to stand, to pray, to put the armor on and all of its equipment, not just some of it, all of it, and to move forward. I've got to close with this story. When I, a year ago, left my job, I had an amazing job. And I came into this position, not because I had to or because I was desperate, because I knew the Lord's calling, and that there was a calling to the church and to work in and for the church and to exercise my gifts in this way. In my old job, I had an amazing job. And, people ask me, how are things going? How do you compare things? And I sometimes say, well, you know, okay, my new job, I make less money. I have a lower title. I have less vacation days. I work more hours. It's the perfect job. But what makes it perfect is not those things. It's that Jesus Christ has aligned himself with the church. And there is only one institution in this world. There's only one organization that has the power to make actual effective change in this world. It's not Harvard. It's not politics. And if you're in those places, praise be to God. But you got to listen. The way you have to be in those places is in and through Jesus Christ in the church. It's the church, his body, which has the power and the might. The very same might that raised Jesus Christ from the dead is the might that has been put into the church. And we must exercise it together. Lord Jesus, we pray in Jesus' name that you would fill us. And we bind you, Satan, in Jesus' name. We tell you, Satan, get out of here and slither back to the pit from which you came. You will not prevail in Jesus' name. You will not prevail over this people. And we pray, O Lord, that you empower us for your glory. Amen.